In Greece, during the prime of Olympian gods, Achilles is born as a demigod child of the mortal hero Peleus and the sea goddess Thetis. While they had made love to conceive the child, they conflict in how they should handle the boy's divinity. Thetis, as a loving mother, wants her son to be akin to the gods, immortal as they are, and begins to warm Achilles in holy flames to extinguish his human blood in favor of being fully divine. Opposed to this, Peleus pleads to his wife to halt the ritual, crying, "That would destroy Achilles as a human." Hearing him out, Thetis accepts this point of view and a compromise is made. Achilles' entire body is turned immortal, with one small exception. His heel is spared and remains human. This may seem trivial, but is important enough to Peleus that he is willing to risk his marriage in the process. Once the bathing is complete, Thetis returns to the ocean, leaving Peleus in charge of the baby boy. From that day forward, Achilles is invincible against all wounds, unless he is struck in his heel. He is harmed in an act of friendship, or another divine being with blood of a god attacks him. Elsewhere, on Mount Pelion, lives the greatest centaur sage, Charon. He is born of the patron of harvest and earth, Cronus, and the nymph, Philyra. From her intimacy with Cronus, Philyra's child takes the form of both man and horse, which she finds shameful. As a result, neither of his parents truly love him. Regardless, thanks to his blood, he is practically a divine spirit, endowed with great wisdom from his father, as well as the sun god Apollo and the goddess of the hunt, Artemis. He goes on to teach many awesome heroes, such as Heracles, Jason of the Argonauts, and Asclepius. His instructions range from words, songs, poems, virtues, manners, hunting, writing, combat, and even healing. While he has his own wife, Chariclo, and a child to love and care for, he has an affinity with humans, impressed by their vulnerability and consequential bravery. Such is fortunate then, when Peleus, an old friend, brings his son Achilles to be tutored by the renowned centaur. Charon, of course, accepts his friend's request and takes on Achilles as his student for the following 9 years. In the absence of Peleus, Charon and Achilles develop a close bond like that of a father and his son. He serves as a stern, kind, and attentive father figure for the gifted child during his most vulnerable years. While Achilles is the son of a hero, blessed by the Olympian gods, he amasses many admirers and rivals, but very few people he can call his friends. Charon is an exception, one whom Achilles can trust. Over time, the centaur's gentle and serious words embed themselves within the boy's mind. Before Charon's eyes, Achilles grows up hastily, now a tall and powerful man. Achilles' once flimsy spear attacks have become godlike thrusts. In sport, he performs as a brilliant sprinter whom no one can stop or tame. With a single glance, he can distinguish between poisonous and edible fauna, and even heal others when injured. He acquires all these skills by the age of 10. Alas, the time comes when Charon admits he has nothing left to teach the boy, and they must part ways. Charon and his wife bid farewell to Achilles with some final words. "Master, Lady Chariclo, thank you for coming this far with me. Take care, Achilles. Stay safe and watch your health." Chariclo lovingly wraps her arms around the boy, while Charon considers the only thing he can still teach, the importance of loving others with all his heart, a lesson he hopes Achilles will understand from his wife's sincerity. At last, Achilles readies for departure, affirming, "I'll be all right. I'll do my best to make sure I don't shame myself as a student of Charon." Charon pats Achilles on the head, admiring how the boy speaks honest, thoughtful words at such a young age. As a final farewell, Charon declares, "You have grown well, Achilles. However, neither Peleus nor we are the ones whom you ought to repay. You need not burden yourself. You are already a hero." Achilles, taken aback, nods hastily before turning around, rubbing his teary eyes with his arm. "I'll be off, Master." In life, the two will never meet again, going their separate ways. The two of them live lives that are tragically cut short. Charon meets a premature end after being caught in a struggle between Heracles and his fellow centaurs. The centaurs find themselves intoxicated from the released fumes of Dionysus' sacred wine. In their stupor, they attack Heracles, forcing him to drive them back with poisonous arrows tipped with potent hydra venom. Amidst this feud, Charon is mistakenly struck by one of these arrows. While adept at healing, there is nothing Charon can do about this particularly horrific injury, and is unable to bear the intense pain. In his suffering, Charon yearns for the sweet release of death, but is unable to die while immortal. Thus, to free himself from agony, Charon passes his immortality onto Zeus, who later grants it to Prometheus. By sacrificing an important element of his divinity, Charon is finally able to die and escape the pain. This becomes a tragic event for all involved, and in lamentation, Zeus grants Charon a place in the night sky as the constellation Sagittarius. Achilles, on the other hand, lives on up until the onset of the Trojan War. It is then that his mother, Thetis, comes to him with a question. Do you wish to live a long and peaceful life without having your name recognized by the masses? Or do you wish to live the short life of a hero with brilliant achievements in battle? Sadly, it seems his mother has prophesied his untimely death should he join in the war. Rather, she had known it since his birth, playing a key part in her wanting to make her son completely immortal. To grant him his humanity, even if only a small sliver, would guarantee his inevitable death. Regardless, Achilles chooses to continue fighting, even after learning of his fate. He swears an oath to his mother that he shall live and die as a hero, without any regrets. Thus, Achilles participates in the Trojan War as a soldier of the ancient Greek army, where his accomplishments stack up tenfold. With his father's spear in hand, he rides into battle on a chariot led by three valiant steeds, two of which are divine horses granted to him by Poseidon. He is Troy's most feared enemy, one who cannot be slain or even receive wounds in combat. Sadly, however, while Achilles himself cannot be harmed, his friends certainly can. More specifically, his most beloved friend, Patroclus, is struck down in battle by the Trojan warrior Hector. This deals a wound to Achilles, deeper than any blade could, and he is driven to madness at the loss of his friend. Fueled by hatred, Achilles confronts Hector on the battlefield, and after a harrowing confrontation, Achilles strikes down his opponent. For revenge, Achilles ties Hector to the end of his chariot and mercilessly drags his corpse across the war zone for all to see. This disrespect and humiliation angers the sun god Apollo. In other words, Achilles' hatred circles back around to him. In addition, Achilles' weak spot is accidentally revealed as a result of the duel. Following Hector's death, an army of Amazonist daughters of Ares, god of war, arrive to assist the Trojans. Their queen, Penthesilea, faces Achilles in a duel, but suffers a humiliating loss, killed by Achilles' spear. Of all his opponents, Achilles genuinely regrets having struck her down, tarnishing her beauty, and becomes hesitant to fight against other women. The war continues, and even after being warned to restrain his rampage, Achilles continues to annihilate his opponents, and Apollo is driven to action. The Trojan army's bowman, Paris, whose elopement with Helen of Sparta served as the spark for the entire war, aims to defeat Achilles, not only as an adversary, but as the one who murdered his brother Hector. Coming to his aid, Apollo intervenes, empowering Paris's arrow to fly true and strike Achilles in his mortal heel. Severely wounded, Achilles is practically defenseless against a further onslaught of arrows, many of which strike his heart. Achilles, knowing full well of his demise, continues his assault until his body finally gives out and he falls to the ground. Comparably, the Greek hero's life is brief, yet filled with renown, serving as a critical piece in his army's victory. While leading entirely different lives, both Achilles and his mentor Charon share a bond profound enough to transcend life itself, as they are each recorded into the throne of heroes for their deeds. In the modern era, in preparation for the Great Grail War in Trephus, Achilles and Charon are summoned on opposite sides of the conflict. Achilles finds himself serving the Red Faction, led almost entirely by Shiro Kotomine of the Church. While he has no wish for the Holy Grail to grant, he enjoys this opportunity to continue his pursuit of heroic combat. Kayron, on the other hand, answers the Grail's call to fulfill a distinct wish, to regain the immortality he gave up to Prometheus. He explains to his master, Fiore, that he does not seek immortality because he is fond of it, but rather because it was a gift from his parents that he should have held on to. Even without his parents' love, he wishes to retain the blood bond he shared with them. Kayron chooses to materialize in the body of a human, intentionally denying himself access to his centaur half. This is a strategic means of hiding his identity, as only one hero is known to resemble the centaur constellation Sagittarius. Hiding his true name takes priority, even though it comes at the cost of his combat parameters. Fortunately, he finds this convenient, as it allows him to push Fiore's wheelchair about. While the tactic itself is wise to employ, because both he and his pupil are servants in the war, neither can hide their identities for long. On their first encounter, the two mark each other as targets, aiming to test their strength and progress over the years. Just how strong did his student Achilles become after venturing off so long ago? The chance to determine which of them is superior lingers in their minds as they obey their masters. In battle, Achilles benefits greatly as a servant from his world-renowned fame. His immortality above all else is embodied in the noble phantasm Andreas Amarantos, heroism's eternal man, Amaranth of the Brave, nullifying all attacks that fail to hit his weak point or come at the hands of a divine opponent. While he is compatible with various servant classes, he fights in Romania under the Rider class, where he can prioritize his chariot noble phantasm, Troius Tragodia, Tempestuous Immortal Chariot. This powerful chariot, when pulled by his three horses, Xanthos, Thalius, and Pedasus, allow him to take to the sky and charge forward like lightning. Recognized as a skilled sprinter, Achilles makes use of one of his noble phantasms, Dromius Cometus, Comet Form, to run the distance of an entire battlefield in a single breath, allowing him to instantly close the gap between himself and any opponent in his field of vision. Granted, this particular ability is only active when exposing his mortal heel. Unlike Kayron, Achilles' parameters are bolstered by his skill, Affections of the Goddesses, giving him a clear advantage. He uses his meteor spear, Diatrekon Asterlonke, spear tip of the star traversing the skies, to penetrate the hearts and skulls of his enemies. Out of his regret for slaying Penthesilea, he refuses to call its true name upon women. As the ultimate pinnacle of noble phantasms, Achilles possesses a divine construct made from the smithing god Hephaestus, a shield called Achilles Cosmos, the miniature world enclosed by the azure sky. With it, he can defend virtually any attack by enclosing it in a bounded field that takes the form of another world. Despite suffering a penalty for not fighting in his centaur form, Kayron is still extremely formidable. He makes up for his losses with the skill Wisdom of Divine Gift, which improves his other abilities via the wisdom he demonstrated in life. This allows him to step out of his role as an archer and even fight in close quarters with the oldest of all mixed martial arts forms, Pancration. As a mentor, he is able to grant skills to his fellow servants in the Black Faction, helping on the strategic front as well as in direct confrontations. As an archer, he can fire off shots with extreme precision at an unbelievable speed. Manifested from the legend that Sagittarius is always aiming at the scorpion in the sky, Scorpius, Kayron's ultimate noble phantasm, Antares Snipe, Heavenly Scorpion Single Shot, allows him to fire a single shot down from the stars in the sky. Outside of battle, the two heroes handle different issues regarding their respective factions. Achilles struggles to bring peace to Atalante, who is torn by her inability to save Jack the Ripper. On the other hand, Kayron does his best to support his master Fiore in finally confronting her past and inability to kill others. Regardless, the two confront each other one last time in the skies above Romania, battling atop commercial jetliners. The two are fairly well matched, as one had taught the other how to fight in the first place. While Kayron knows not only of Achilles' weakness, but also his habits and techniques, there is one ability Achilles has developed that not even his mentor is aware of. Using his spear, he invokes a dual field, generating a fair battleground in which no outside elements can interfere. Thus, the two are separated from the rest of the world in their own dimensional space, where they engage in a chaotic fistfight. Achilles emerges victorious, but Kharon refuses to go down easily. As soon as the duel field collapses, Kharon activates Antares Snipe, sending down an arrow straight into Achilles' heel. In reverence to his master, Achilles agrees to fulfill Kharon's last request to somehow assist his allies in their fight against Shiro Kotomine. Making due on his promise, Achilles gifts his divine shield to Astolfo, greatly influencing the end of the war. Having conquered his mentor, Achilles sets his eyes on Atalante, whose madness has fully consumed her. With the little vitality he has left, Achilles sacrifices himself to put Atalante at rest. In the end, Achilles, and Kharon's bond as student and teacher, is able to assist greatly in preventing the invocation of Heaven's Feel. Thank you for watching this video. If you enjoyed it, please like, comment, and subscribe to Otaku Daikun for more anime lists, reviews, discussions, lore videos, live streams, and the Holy Waifu Wars. If you're interested in seeing this channel grow, please consider becoming a patron or donating in a super chat during any of my weekly live streams. Also, feel free to check the description for my social media profiles, including an ever-growing Discord full of fans of anime and the Fate series. Until next time, celebrate your fandom!